Hi, welcome back. I am Rakesh Naik. Today we are going to discuss about asymptotic notation. This asymptotic notation is basically refers to an algorithm. And what is an algorithm? An algorithm is basically a method that is used for compute a given problem. It means what we are going to say is a step-by-step process or a blueprint of a program. Before writing an exact program, we are going to write an algorithm. Basically, an algorithm can be defined as a finite set of instructions which accomplishes some task. Can we say anything, any step-by-step process can be an algorithm? No. Basically, there are few properties. If that satisfies, we say it is an algorithm. And the properties are, it must have zero or more inputs. It must produce an output. Each instruction must be clear and unambiguous. And it must terminate after a finite number of steps. This is what an algorithm is. Now, why generally we study an algorithm? We study algorithm to devise an algorithm, validate an algorithm, analyze an algorithm, and test a program. Basically, we will be concentrating on analysis of algorithm here. Let us assume there is a problem and there are several approaches to solve that problem. Let us say approach 1, approach 2, up to approach n are there. Now, in order to identify the best approach, we must have some kind of a criteria based on which we will choose an approach and write a program based on it. So basically, before implementing any kind of algorithm, we see mostly a time or space for this purpose. We see that in how much less time the program can be done and how much space it is taking to get the program done. Basically, we generally find a trade-off between time and space. Whenever we take more time, we generally use less space, or when we use more space, we generally complete a particular task in less time. So regarding that, we are going to discuss. Then what is the time complexity? Let us go to the definition first and then gradually we'll go and try to solve problems. Keep watching. The definition of time complexity says the time complexity TP of a program P is a sum of compile time, CP, and execution time. Okay, basically compile time is constant, which it generally don't depend on the variable characteristics. So that's why we say the time complexity is nothing but the compile time plus characteristics that is represented for addition, for subtraction, and all those things. And where n is the number of inputs given. Now what is the space complexity? Space complexity is the amount of memory required to run a particular program. Now whenever we are running a particular program, its space consists of two parts. One is a fixed part that doesn't depend on the input or the output, and another part is a variable part that need component variable. It means the space complexity SP is equal to the fixed part, that is C, and SP the component variable part. If you are a new user to this channel, there is a red button down there. Click that and subscribe this channel. Now let us talk about asymptotic notation. Let us go to the definition first. Now the definition says, if fn is a function, and I'll say this function is of order g of n, or I'll say fn is belongs to big O of gn, if and only if there exists a constant c and n0 such that f of n supposed to be less than or equal to c of gn for all n, where n is greater than or equal to 0. It means what? We are going to find a asymptotically equivalent function gn which will satisfy this condition, and we'll name it in the form of big O. Let us try to have a graph to understand this. Let us say we have taken in x-axis the number of input, and the y-axis the time taken, and let us say this is the function fn and this is the function c into gn. You see, after certain time n0, all the values of c into gn is greater than or equal to fn. So in this kind of condition, I'll say Gn is Bgo of Fn. So Fn equal to Bgo of Gn. So what actually we are doing? We are trying to find a function Gn such that it is greater than or equal to Fn for some n greater than equal to n0. Few properties are there for big O. Let us see one by one. If f of n equal to g of n, then anything multiplied to f of n is also will be equal to order of g of n, where x is any number or any constant greater than 0. The second property is, if f of n is order of h of n and gn is order of kn, then fn plus gn will be equal to order of maximum of hn and kn. Similarly, if we want to multiply fn and gn, we'll be having order of hn into kn. We'll use these formulas or these properties to have some problems in the coming videos. Let us see an example. Let us say f of n equal to 2n plus 5 and gn equal to n. So can we say fn is of order gn? Let us see. According to the formula given by Big O, f of n supposed to be less than or equal to c into gn. It means 2n plus 5 supposed to be less than or equal to c into n. Gn is equal to n. So what we are going to do? We are trying to find a value c. For which value of c this inequality will hold? Here we can see c is greater than 2, this inequality holds. Let us substitute it, let it be 3. So 2n plus 5 is less than equal to 3n. So in other words, if I want to say n is greater than equal to 5. So we got two values here. According to the definition of Big O, n is greater than some positive integer and c is also some positive integer. So we can say for every n is greater than equal to 5 and c is greater than 2 or greater than equal to 3, we can say this inequalities holds. So we can say f of n is of order g of n. So if you want to plot the graph also, you can see this is our graph 3n with blue line, and line if you want to plot 2n plus 5, this is a red one. So after n equal to 5, you see all the values of gn is greater than f of n. It means I can say g of n is the upper bound of f of n. Basically, we cannot take upper bound. So we can think that instead of 3n, can we take 4n or 5n or n square or 2 to the power n or so many other things? Yes, we can take. All of them will be upper bound. But 3n will be, among all these upper bounds, it will be the least one. So we are going to choose the least upper bound, that is 3n. In order to find the big O, it's supposed to be least upper bound. So if you are liking this video, you can share clicking on this button, and your friends also will be getting benefited. Please do share with your friends. Let us continue the definition of omega. The function f of n equal to omega of g of n if and only if there exists a positive constant c and n0 such that f of n is greater than equal to c into gn for all n is equal to n0. Now what we are going to do? In the big O notation, it was less than or equal to. In omega, it is greater than or equal to. Let us see. In x-axis, we are taking number of inputs n. In y-axis, it is the time. And this is the function f of n. And we are taking a function g of n. C into g of n is the line given in the red. So after certain value n equal to n0, all the values of gn are less than or equal to f of n. So what we are going to do? We are trying to find a function g of n such that gn is smaller than or equal to fn after some n greater than or equal to n0. Let us see the example. Let us say fn equal to 2n plus 5 and gn equal to n. So can we say fn equal to omega of gn? Let us check. According to the formula of big omega, f of n supposed to be greater than or equal to c into gn. It means what? 2n plus 5 supposed to be greater than or equal to c into n. Now we have to determine the value of c. For what value of c this inequality holds? Now this inequality holds for any value of c which is equal to 1. So let us substitute here 1, the minimum value. So what we will get? N is greater than or equal to minus 5. As we know that the c and n supposed to be positive, so we can write n is greater than or equal to 0. So we can say f of n is omega of g of n. So if you want to see the line plotted here, the red one is gn, the blue one is fn. For all values of n, gn values is always less than or equal to 2n plus 5. There are so many other notations coming up. If you are liking it, please share with your friends. If anything you are not able to understand, please write to me in the comment section. So let us start with the theta definition. The function fn equal to theta of gn, if and only if there exists a positive constant c1, c2 and n0. There are three positive constants we need here, where c1 into gn is less than equal to fn is less than equal to c2 into gn for all n equal to n0. What is the meaning of this? Here there are two different c1 and c2 we are going to find. For one, it's supposed to be less than, and for the other, it's supposed to be greater than. Let us plot and try to understand. Let us take x-axis as number of inputs, y-axis as time. Let us say this is our function fn, and let us say this is our gn. Whenever we are multiplying c1, this is the graph, and whenever we are multiplying c2, this is the graph. So here, fn is bounded between this c2 gn and c1 gn. So what we are going to do here is, if n is bounded by c1 gn and c2 gn, we say f of n is theta of gn, where c1 and c2 supposed to be different. That is important. Here also n0, whatever we are mentioning, after n0 it's supposed to satisfy. After n is greater than equal to n0, this equation supposed to satisfy. Let us see an example. Let us say fn equal to 3n plus 5 and gn equal to n. So can we say fn equal to theta of gn? So according to the definition of theta, c1 into gn supposed to be less than equal to fn is less than equal to c2 gn. So first of all, we need to identify the value of c1 and c2. So let us take the first part. C1 n is less than equal to 3n plus 5. So for value c1 is less than equal to 2, this inequality will hold. So let us take 2. So 2n always will be less than equal to 3n plus 5. It means n is greater than equal to 0. Similarly, take the other part. 3n plus 5 is less than equal to c2 into n. So if we want to solve here, we can say c2 value greater than equal to 4, this inequality will hold. So here we can say n is greater than equal to 5. So here we got c1 and c2 value, both of them are positive, and n value, both of them are positive. So we can say fn equal to theta of gn. Now if you want to plot it, you can see c2 into gn, whenever we are taking that is 4n, is the blue line is 4n, the red line is 3n plus 5, and the green line is 2n. You can see after n0 equal to 5, c1 gn is less than equal to fn is less than equal to c2 gn is satisfying. So I can say f of n is equal to theta of gn. Before talking about small o definitions, I'd like to request if any problems are there, do write to me in the comment section so that I can help you out in solving this kind of problem. And do share with your friends, they will also get benefited. Let us start with the definition of small o. The function fn is small o of gn if and only if there exists a positive constant c and n0 such that f of n is strictly less than c into gn. Now in big O notation, less than or equal to, here under small o, it is strictly less than. In other way, if you want to take the limit definition, we can say limit fn by gn equal to 0 as n tends to infinity. Let us see an example. Fn equal to 3n plus 2 and gn equal to n square. So can we say Fn is small o of gn? So take the limit. Limit 3n plus 2 by n square. When n tends to infinity, the value becomes 0. So therefore, we can say Fn is small o of n square. Now let us see the little omega notation. Here Fn is omega of gn if and only if there exists a positive constant Cn and 0 such that Fn is greater than C into Gn. Under big omega notation, it was greater than or equal to. But under little omega, it is strictly greater than. Or in limit definition, if we want to say, limit Gn by Fn equal to 0 as n tends to infinity. So let us take an example here. Fn equal to n and Gn equal to n square. So we will take limit of n by n square. And the value is 0 as n tends to infinity. So I can say f of n equal to omega of n square. Now basically, if we want to see the big O notation we will be using, it will be giving us the worst case complexity. Omega notation when I am using, it will be giving me the best case complexity, and theta notation will give me the average case complexity. It is giving me a time or a function which my function fn will never exceed that particular time. Similarly, it will never get better than this particular time. And theta notation will give me whenever the big O and omega are same, we are using theta notation. Let us see the properties of asymptotic notation. Now, the first one is transitivity. It means if f of n is equal to theta of gn and gn equal to theta of hn, then f of n equal to theta of hn. It means A implies B, B implies C, then A implies C. It is a function of that kind. So it is applicable to all the notations we learned just now. Let us think about the reflexivity. If Fn equal to big O of Gn and Fn equal to theta of Gn, then we can say Fn equal to omega of Gn. Now for symmetry relation, if Fn equal to theta of Gn, if and only if Gn is equal to theta of Fn. For transport symmetry, if f of n equal to big O of gn, if and only if gn equal to omega of Fn, and Fn equal to small o of gn, if and only if gn equal to omega of Fn. So all these properties, if we want to put it in one slide, we can say for this big O, omega, theta, small o and small omega, only the theta notation will satisfy the symmetry relation. Only big O, omega and theta notation will be giving me the reflexive relation. And all the relations will be satisfying the transitive relation. If we are talking about transpose, big O to omega and omega to big O are transposed. Theta to theta are transposed. Then small o to omega and omega to small o can also be transposed. Thank you for listening this video till the end. Keep watching, keep learning. Please subscribe, share and comment to this particular video. Thank you.